But you can play it, and the other team is just better than you. Yep. So sometimes there isn't an answer for what's being thrown at you. Flash Wolves have very skilled players. They also play the map in a very solid and structured way, which means that if you can't get early advantages, if you can't push them off the objective-focused game that they want to run with, there's very little avenues to get back into the game.
And sometimes you do just have to say, hey, we met a better team on the day. It's a learning experience for us. We can take that learning back into the LCL and then hopefully come back for Worlds in 6 months' time and come and challenge once again. Now, we do have a few changes, or one change, in the pick-ban phase. Vega on the red side have gone Kalista into Akali bounce.
Yeah, and this is a coach's job, right? When you're in that kind of slug of they're outperforming us, they're beating us to positions, they're beating us in lane, we need an adaptation. That's where you're coaching stuff. That's when Envy's job becomes difficult. You need to generate some lead. You need to get some volatility in. And I love the adaptation here. They've gone with, let's deny the strongest solo lanes. We need better counter picks. We don't have anything for these two. They've played it, you know, three times now, two times in the case of the Akali. Let's get rid of it, start from scratch, see what we can rebuild.
And we'll see where Flash Wolves go, because now the Nocturne and the Jarvan are available for them if they want it. It's still the Rek'Sai, though. Boogie has had an incredible performance on that so far, and we'll be picking it up once again.
Yeah, I believe third game on Rek'Sai, game one lost where he tried to steal out the Elder Drake. Game two, dominant performance, and now going to be picking it up again in game four. Was also first rotation from Vega, so obviously high priority from both teams on this pick.
Has been high priority throughout the entire tournament as well. Could be a little bit of something interesting here as the Morgana is hovered by Vega. Could be bot, could be mid, could be support, could go anywhere.
Good negative pick in the mid lane as well. In the case that it just pushes out, doesn't lose lane too spectacularly, and is a very good team fight. Full AP Morgana, Black Shield, plus the ultimate provides a ton of utility. Also, we've seen potentially it can be played by Gadget in the bottom lane if they want to run, you know, something a little bit cheesier like Morgana Pike. Or as you mentioned, if Santos wants to play it, you know, something like Nautilus goes support, is a very good denial pick there as well.
We'll see where Vega go for their second pick here, and we'll see if Flash Wolves decide that they want to go for these solo lane picks in the first phase as well.
Yeah, so far, what we've seen in this draft as Shen's picked up is a lot more global flavor, probably going to be a teleport run on Morgana if it is in the AD carry or mid lane position. And this is a lot more of what we saw from Flash Wolves domestically. Mm-hmm. Take a good AD carry, take a good support here, would expect something like Galio to come out or Tahm Kench to match the global of Shen. And then just leave our solo laners, you know. Our two preferred solo laners gone. They can't hit the champion pool much more because we haven't shown them anything else.
And Vega have actually gone back to something that worked so well for them earlier on. Get the Aatrox. Now you can ban out counters to the Aatrox in the second phase. And it makes it so much easier for Vega to find a good top matchup.
Certainly could be the case, and see whether they go towards something like a Jace or Aurelia. They've already banned away the Aurelia on the side of Flash Wolves. So really only Jace is the last lane dominant top laner up and available. Would like to see that be banned away.
All right, well done. Good prediction on the day there, Spawn.
One of one.
One of one so far today. Hey, 100% win record.
Yeah, on the flip side for Flashers, I'm expecting them to play a push and control mage, so I expect them to try and hit away either, I was going to say, top or mid or jungle champion pool right now. Mm-hmm. I think that hitting jungle is kind of interesting because you have Rek'Sai and the strongest early game jungler. So it doesn't do all that much for me unless you're willing to take away something super early game focused like a Xin Zhao. I would rather see them hit something that they think is going to be played into the control mages, you know, something like a Corki that scales incredibly well on the side of Vega. Yeah. In saying that, could always be that mid lane Morgana, and you know, that's where an AD carry or, you know, whatever the heck, maybe a Heimerdinger ban. Gadget doesn't play AD carries, that's why I'm fishing for another relevant ban down there. Maybe Heimer is just a good denial pick at this stage.
I think Heimer would be a good ban just because it is difficult to play into, but you do have the Varus Tahm Kench, right? So it's relatively good lane in that bottom side of the map. We will see where Flash Wolves go. Still a lot of options available for them, and I wouldn't be surprised if we just see them play a little bit more of a conventional Flash Wolves style here, you know? You can take some early skirmishes, maybe get something like the Urgot up towards the top side, maybe get something like Vladimir in the mid lane as well, just things that we tend to see from Flash Wolves.
Yeah, this is the ban that Froskuren was actually calling for in Game 2 to be picked up by Ananasik. Take away the Kindred. If you're going to play team fight, Kindred is one of the best junglers to have because it gives you that second shot at getting it right. Also can absorb some key ultimates, something like Boogie's Rek'Sai ultimate.
We'll be the Lee Sin locked in here for Ananasik. He's played that once this tournament, won on it as well. Gives you a little bit more aggression. You can go for some of those early plays, which is what we want to see from Vega.
Yeah, now this composition will give away whether it's a 4-1 or a 1-3-1. Azir certainly points further to the 4-1. While she can play 1-3-1 in a lot of compositions, I was going to say with maybe an Orianna, some other form of control mage, this is one of Rather's most picked champions. Mm-hmm. Azir really struggles in the side lane, especially given the fact that they've potentially held on to a mid lane pick for last. Something like a LeBlanc can come out and really punish that. So I prefer the Orianna. Certainly buys enough time for, you know, Xiaosi as well as Betty to be able to rotate down there. And talking about 1-3-1, would be remiss to not mention Ryze. The best top laner and mid laner, I feel, in a 1-3-1 comp as the game progresses. Scales incredibly well, has gank assist, as well as the fact that it's so hard to kill and tie down in that side lane.
It's the first time we've actually seen Hanabi play the Ryze if he locks it in, and actually haven't seen Rather play it either during the regular season. So not a very common pick for the Flash Wars. It will be Hanabi taking it up towards the top lane. Final pick was Syndra for Nomads.
Yeah, old school counter pick coming out against the Orianna. If you're able to get ahead in lane, can be very oppressive as the Orianna, especially given the fact that, you know, you're running into Lee Sin. This is probably, as far as mid-jungle 2v2 goes, the hardest lane to navigate. You've got to Lee Sin with all of his mobility, with the CC. You've got Syndra there with the gank assist, with the burst damage. And we are seeing Gadget go back towards a different pick.
Yeah.
The worry here now is, where does the AD damage come from? Unless this Aatrox is significantly ahead, going to be hard to run in with any form of physical damage. It means that team fights do get progressively harder as the game goes on.
I mean, boss was very, very strong the last time we saw this Aatrox. And if you're playing up against a 1-3-1, like, how much can you actually fight Flash Wolves if you get past that 25-30 minute mark? Aren't you looking for fights earlier on?
Yeah, it certainly could be the case, and I'm certainly not taking anything away from that. However, if you are running Tahm Kench, Orianna, Ryze, you always have the option to go back to team fights as well. Orianna, great team fighter. Ryze can also be a great team fighter in the right circumstances. So whilst I expect at some point in this game for Flash Wolves to break up the map, try and use their superior control and vision to be able to take key objectives, I do think that, you know, they still have the ability to throw down if 10 people are on the same screen.
Definitely do. With Vega Squadron, last chance saloon for them for today, at least. Of course, they play up against Fongvu Buffalo. If they lose this series in our matchup tomorrow, the winner of that will go through to the MSI main stage. Flash Wolves have been there 3 times before, and they're trying to make it lucky number 4. They will, with a victory in this game.
And what we've seen so far in this series, Medic, is a team that control the early games, controls the mid and the late as well, whilst Vega did it in a much more slow, drawn-out fashion. It was a clean victory the first time around. Flash Wolves in the last 2 games have been able to generate massive gold leads. And now the pressure comes to Vega. Can they get something rolling anywhere on Summoner's Rift?
I do like that phrase as well, the pressure comes to Vega, because it almost felt like that's the story of this series. If you look back at Game 1, the game, like, you came into the series thinking Flash Wolves are going to 3-0. You think they're the most dominant team out of the two. And I'll hold this thought for a second. Betty's going to back off. And I'm sure Vega came in with that mentality as well. Oh, Betty spots out the Shen. It's a ward down. Binding doesn't connect. I'm sure Vega came in thinking, you know, this is just practice. We're probably going to lose to the Flash Wolves. Probably going to get 3-0'd. And then they started winning. And then they started dominating the Flash Wolves. And after about the 30-minute mark in that game one, I think you started to see the nerves creep in. I think you started seeing a little bit of tentativeness, a little bit of over-eagerness from the team. And maybe now that they've been pushed back so many times so often, Vega will have a few less nerves and be a little bit more laissez-faire with their gameplay.
Can always go that way, right? When your back is against the wall, you either play scared or you play like you have nothing to lose. And I would like to see the latter come out. Just send a message into tomorrow's game. Do want to point out some key rune choices right now. Double spellbook going to be picked up on the side of Flash Wolves. That is going to be a spellbook Orianna mid lane being able to swap into the cleanse to avoid some ganks will be nice as the game progresses. It's going to be Glacial Augment picked up for the Morgana in the mid lane. So we're expecting Hextel KLP into something like the Spooky Ghost of Twin Shadows coming out there as well. Does lend itself to more gank setup. And the fact that they've already got CC in both members of the bottom lane does mean that if Tahm Kench steps a little bit too far forward, they will take him down.
Until Gadget levels up that W, though, they are just going to get pushed in towards this bottom lane. Betty and Xiaosi able to force Santas and Gadget down underneath their tower. Usually you look for something like the Lost Chapter first on the Morgana, and then level up that Tormented Soil, and you can counter push those waves.
This has been scouted out here, Medic. You can see Ananasik has stepped over wards to be able to get into this location. Has to back away.
On his way up, you can see as well, Hanabi quicker on the react from that top lane, had the push in the wave, and Ananasik's just going to have to back away. You can't stay around where you don't know where Ryze is. Boogie not doing the blue buff, though, and Ananasik maybe looking for a gank towards mid, as Rather has been chunked out just a little bit.
Probably wants to help you. Quicker level 3. Great flash.
Oh.
Yeah. Great flash.
Indeed it was.
That was probably a guaranteed kill coming across there. You have so much damage coming out of the electrocute. You don't have heal available. You don't have cleanse, something like a barrier. So has to burn the flash early. Even if you do survive, you have to immediately probably recall and burn teleport to get back into the lane. So you just ultimately will lose another summoner spell regardless and not have any ability to force in. And you can see that Nanasek getting busy one more time on summoner's rift.
Still only level two, trying to control that early game. He who controls the early game controls the entire matchup, but Shaoxi and Betty able to react, know that Ananasik could be on that bottom side of the map, and now Ananasik will just have to retreat back in towards his jungle.
And closer to what we saw game number one, the ability to get busy in the early game. That time it was on the Sejuani, did catch up ultimately in farm, but stalking around the lanes, trying to generate any form of advantage for his team.
He's trying to keep track of Boogie there as well. He popped out a Sonic Wave towards the Krug, so you know Boogie's been down towards that bottom side of the map. Now, does just need to get some of his own jungle. You know, at some point, you start falling too far behind in XP.
And you can see Boogie goes for the recross and goes towards the Raptor camp, so immediately pings out the camps that are still up and available for an Ananasik as well.
Nice little steal away there by No Man's, though. Stops Boogie from getting all of that extra gold from the large Raptor. And relatively even, keeping track of the junglers is so important in these early games. Lots of pings actually coming out towards the top side as well from Hanabi, showing Boogie that there's a lot of wards.
Ooh, and a really nice donation for this early in the game. Rek'Sai going to sacrifice some experience to be able to get Rather ahead. The fact that this is a summoner spell less Orianna that has been given that blue buff at only 4.5 minutes into the game does mean that the push is going to be quite oppressive into No Man's, but Rather will have to look to navigate some gank feel as this laning phase progresses.
So how much does this actually give Rather in the lane? Because it, like, you can spam out, you can push the wave in, but what does that actually allow Flash Wolves to do?
So what you hope it allows Flash Wolves to do is access the river first and be able to fight for things like Scuttle Crabs, early dragons, and also, in the long run, relieve a lot of kill threat that would be mid lane. Because if you're making No Man's play against the wave as opposed to playing against the Orianna, a lot of that kill threat goes down. The chunk isn't going to be available. Lee Sin probably not going to 100 and 0 without ultimate available, which is still a while away, is only level 4. So just turns what would have been a weak laning phase into a pushing and, you know, vision control advantage.
Yeah, you already talked about the power of the mid jungle 2v2. If you can get your mid ahead, get that extra experience, get that extra push, extra pressure, makes it a lot harder for you.
Yeah, and not only that, the two wards that are around mid lane at the moment, the one right there and this spied on the Raptor camp as well, means that they have a side of the lane to push towards. Even without the summoner spells available, if you just play towards the top lane, you're going to be able to know if the gank is coming, you know, be able to navigate yourself around that even with no summoner spells. So really like how they set up Rather for success here. Face check coming out.
And Ananasik face checks into there by Boogie. Lands the Unburrow. Sonic Wave Wrestling Strike combo comes out, but the damage from Boogie is pretty strong. Rather rotating up first because he's got that push in the mid lane, and it all comes together, Sport.
And you can see Ananasik wants to get back involved in the play. Ultimate is available now for No Man's.
And Ananasik still only level 4 though. Can't really get in towards Rather. Rather will be able to force him away, and No Man's once again is caught underneath his tower. There has been a bit of a CS lead developing down towards the bottom side of the map, as well as Betty and Shaoxi continue to push in Gadget and Santas. And because of that, you know, you're looking at a 20 farm difference between Gadget and Betty.
And honestly, just CS advantages everywhere. Mid lane due to that blue buff. Ooh, Shaoxi.
That's a little bit of a cheeky sidestep.
Yeah, it certainly was. Just battling Santas there in the bottom lane. Also, the fact that Hanabi was able to recall, not use teleport, and still maintain a CS advantage. Obviously, now replicated for boss, but you can see about a creep wave advantage as well in the top lane. Flash Wolves just showing their mastery over this stage of the game.
Yeah, getting the plates down in the bottom lane as well means they're about 2,000 gold ahead, or 1,500 at the moment. Now, what we usually see from Flash Wolves here is they go for these neutral objectives. With 7 minutes in, there's a Mountain Drake down towards that bottom side for them. They have pushing mid, they have pushing bot.
They got double control wards in bottom river. You can see exactly where they want to play around. At the same time, Hanabi has his weak pink ward as well. That means he's allowed to push up. If no CC register, is going to be able to use that ultimate to escape. And this is where Vega did a very good job in game number one of throwing the curveball. They matched the Rift Herald. They were able to take the first dragon. They really upset the pace at which Flash Wolves wanted to play the game. Now, unfortunately for Vega, it looks like this game is following a very predictive and deliberate strategy. Yeah. That blue buff handover was a very deliberate take. You could see that when Boogie got invaded, he didn't take the blue buff. He went back to his wolf camp. This is obviously a predetermined strategy that they like to implement with the Orianna.
Scatter the Weak is going to land. There's the Unleashed Power as well, but the exhaust comes out. Shockwave used, and Anasik not underneath the tower, and can't really do much more. Tom Kench on his way up with the Abyssal Voyage. Boogie there as well. Abyssal Voyage was cancelled. Santas goes in with the Taunt, but now he's the one to be caught out. Xiaosi trading. There's the teleport in the mid lane as an Anasik, and Nomads will get the first kill. Santas solo. Betty flashes in. One for one trade across the map now. Boss did TP into mid, so his TP is down, and Hanabi did not join that fight in mid lane.
Great job from Vega Squadron to be able to upset the mid lane. We've talked about this so much. Boss now looking for the flank, forcing away. No Man's needs to get an advantage in this 1v1, and the whole of the team is helping out and ensuring that can happen.
Well, you said we wanted to see Vega upset the apple cart a bit, make a reactive play, make a proactive, not reactive play, against Flash Wolves. And that's what they did with this mid lane fight.
Yeah, they certainly did, and we mentioned the push. No safe side right now, playing towards the neutral part of the lane. We'll have to spend summoner spells again. Looks like it's going to turn, but great job from Santas. Looks like he burnt a flash to cancel that, able to get the taunt down. And you mentioned that Hanabi not looking to join. Did use a realm hop, you know, the one station take wasn't enough to get him into the midst of that team fight. And taking another look at Santas, wasn't actually the flash, it was just the ignite.
Oh, ignite.
Any damage stops
it now. Any damage.
And you can see that that will mean that he falls down, but certainly better than being wiped mid lane if the duo was able to join.
Betty did have to burn Flash to get him in the end as well, so that's both those summoners down in the bottom lane, and Nanasik is trying to capitalize on that teleport in from Hanabi. Black Shield down, it's a 3v3 for the moment. Hanabi comes in, knocked airborne straight away. Gadget, though, is caught out, and it's two kills on the board for Flash Wolves. A 1,500 gold lead. Flash Wolves in control of this game.
And some mistimed aggression. We already mentioned the fact that Boss had to use his teleport to get into the mid lane. It was a great job of turning that gank. But then you have to play weak side bottom lane. You have to wait for Santas' ult to become available. Try and attack the Ryze who still has the global. Instead, they fight the bottom side of the map. They fight the wrong side of the map where they don't have any vision set up. Once again, costs them about 2,000 gold, costs them that first rake of the game, control starting to go back towards the flash.
And when you know you're going to be at a man disadvantage, or you could be at a man disadvantage, your map is weak. That side of the map is where you cannot play, and Vega Squadron fell into the trap that we have talked about so many times this tournament.
And Anasik, and we'll hold that thought actually, so this is what we're talking about. Flash forward when you don't have teleport, and no way to stop Ryze's teleport in the top lane. More importantly, you can see Boss isn't even in that lane, so now it's an uneven fight. Went probably as well as it could have there with a nice kick coming across from Anasik, but unfortunately not going to be enough to stop kills going across, not going to be enough to stop that drag.
Yeah, and because Boss was back in base, he doesn't even get an advantage in the top lane out of it. You have 4 plates to 5, only that extra plate, you're equal on CS, Hanabi gets a kill, and now you can see after taking the dragon, what do Flash Wolves do? It's textbook, they go for Rift Home.
But they are also maybe throwing a bit of curveball, they're acting with the Tahm Kench that they want to go for this play, trying to bait Gadget into overextending. And they have the Ryze ultimate in bottom lane. Also, if this doesn't work out, they can just walk straight back up river. Ryze has the semi-global to be able to join the fray. Really like the lane swap that came across from Flash Wolves there.
Yeah, set up for a possible play. Weren't able to enact it, but they don't lose anything out of it because of how they established.
And now they're playing on the side of the map that does have the objective.
Yep.
Whilst there is vision control on top side, now that you've got superior numbers, you can walk in as a 4-man unit, and you can just look to take all of that away. Stan United, however, is available for Shen. So they do have a way to join this fight and make it equal numbers. Hanabi's ultimate is not going to be that far range at only level 9.
The question is how greedy you want to be if you are Flash Wolves. Do you want to just hard force for these objectives when you know you have the lead, or are you willing to be a bit more patient? You'll get towards that Ludens complete on towards the Orianna, get your first item on Hanabi as well, that Seraph's building up, because right now you're in a very strong position. You don't really need to be forcing the tempo too much. Nomad caught out with a shockwave. A kick comes back from Anasik there. Betty gobbled up by Xiaosi. Spat out back towards the tower. The Chain of Corruption did land onto Anasik, locking him in place. Boss with the Infernal Chains can't quite pull back Betty. And now the World Ender about to time out. Boss flashes away. Boogie on the chase. Doesn't have the flash yet, but still looking for the knockup. And Boss will delay with the Darkin Blade. Betty will take him out. And Flash Wolves once again find a kill from an Anasik gank.
And they're trying to force plays on the side of the map where they don't have numbers, which means that if anything goes wrong, if they're not able to execute immediately, they just die. Back-to-back plays. You can argue Santas could have joined there.
Trying to make the play onto Hanabi here. Ooh. Underneath the tower. Pretty good tower dive there by Vega Squadron.
Much better execution of a play, you know, with Black Shield not going to be able to get the root out. And you can see Anasik looking for Betty here as well.
jumps forward with the safeguard, hits the Sonic Wave Chase onto Betty. Betty doesn't really have anywhere to get out, and it's shut down. Betty overextended there, shouldn't have been there by himself.
And you can see that with that pick in the top lane, with no presence in the mid lane for Ratha, that might be the Rift Herald falling across, and Anisic could have continued that leash, still has Santis's ultimate to be able to join the fight. Instead, they slow the pace of the game down. This is when Vega Squadroners look good. When they take their play, they reset and they look for something else.
Don't need to be continually making those desperate plays. Now, Anisic didn't have the smite at the time, which is why I think he re-leashed on that Rift Herald. Didn't want to get in a smite fight with Boogie, but now up towards this top side, trying to play towards the strong side of the map. Gadget has teleport, Betty has it as well, and you can see Betty coming down towards this bottom lane to try and answer Gadget and Santos.
Yeah, and you can see that they've decided that farm on Hanabi is more important than trying to secure the Rift Herald now that plates are about to fall off. Mm-hmm. You're not going to be able to drop that for the additional gold, so what we need is our Ryze to continue that scaling process we've already talked about. Inner side lane will be a Terra as the laning phase progresses. Let's not do anything, you know, rash and continue to force around objectives. We just go back to our scaling. We always have that insurance policy. But you have to say that bringing this gold back by about 1,000 at this stage, yeah, of Vega Squadron has been an improvement in that 7 to 15 minute mark where so many of these games have been decided.
Just slowing down the pace of the game a little bit now as well, which is very good from them. They're going to go for this Rift Herald. Ocean Drake up in a minute. Should be able to secure it, really, because Boogie is down on the bottom side of the map. We are also seeing first completed items just so we can check in to make sure we know what's up. GLP 800 finished on towards Gadget, and there is the Blade of the Ruin King on towards Beth.
And you might think, you know, risky teleport for Gadget, however, does have ultimate and flash available. Oh,
Soul Shack was used there. Shaosi gonna get caught out. Sand United coming in as well. There's the stun lock. Santa's looking for the taunt. Can't quite land it onto Betty. Root used with Chain of Corruption. And the fight onto Gadget as Betty turns it around. Gadget was not in the Spirit Refuge. Santa's was unable to detect his AD carry. And this should be two easy kills for the Flash Wolves. Nothing that Vega Squadron could do.
And a miss execution again. I was going to say Flash as well as Ultimate and Shen means that he's very hard to dive. But however, going aggressive like that seems to be a misplay. Once again, you have numbers on the top side of the map. You're taking Rift Herald, you're going to be able to secure first turret. Why are you trying to win everywhere at once, Medic? A great play top side, followed by a complete blunder bottom.
Just didn't need to go for it, but Gadget, he felt, he tasted blood. He could see it in his eyes. Now Hanabi trading onto boss. The Rift Herald gonna push in. Hanabi should be able to take this one down before it gets too much damage on this tower. One charge off, but then the Rift Herald will fall. Flash Wolves gonna get the Ocean Drake down towards the bottom side. That's their second of the game. 15 minutes in, there's about 2,000 gold in it.
So let's take a look at this. You can see two members moving down. Orianna also could be on the way. All of your members topside of Summoner's Rift. You go for it because you have Stan United, but the miss execution, no taunt landing there. Members coming over the wall in Flashful style.
And Anasu is going to kick Ratha back here, uses the heal, still has the flash. There's the Abyssal Voyage as Shaosi joins the fight. And Anasu forced away, but does get the shockwave, I guess, out of Ratha.
I think that Anasu thought there was someone in Tarmakan's belly there, yeah, because flashed away from a very non-threatening catfish at this stage of the game. However, I like the discipline shown in that play. Okay, we've overextended again. We haven't been able to generate the pick immediately. We got the ultimate out of two members. I'm going to burn my flash. I'm not going to cost my team the game at only 16 minutes in. And Vega showing much more parity to the way they played in game number one.
Couple
of more blunders in the bottom lane, but looking the goods in this game four.
And not letting that gold lead really snowball away, yep, from them. I think that's the big thing for them. Keeping it calm, not making too many desperate plays. Vega in a much stronger position. And this is much more like, as you say, that game one performance all round. Next steps, though, for both these teams, you have to think of cracking these mid lane towers. Still top tower up for the side of Vega. Flash Wolves have a bottom, but if you can break open mid, you can really start getting those deeper wards in, getting extra vision down.
You're absolutely right. And the way you want to do that is by pushing side lanes past the point of mid and gaining control of a side of the jungle. Then when you dip into Fog of War in that area, you're able to threaten the dive. It means it's very hard to defend on something that is immobile, like the Orianna, like the Syndra. So if either jungler or top laner gets control of a side lane, expect for them to try and converge towards that mid lane, open up the map and make the lanes long.
The longer the lane, the better if you want to play these 1-3-1 compositions. Question is exactly how Vega Squadron going to be able to do it, because Flash Wolves seems to have had their number across the course of this series.
And this is what I was speaking about, the difference between Orianna and Azir is the fact that Orianna right now can catch this wave. You know, not going to be under all that much threat because jungle is playing bottom side of Summoner's Rift Knight now. You see where Boogie's position is. Then you have a Tahmkent who has ultimate now back up and available and the ability to cheat into that Fog of War. As long as they control the bottom quadrant of the jungler on the side of the Flash Wolves, then they should be able to continue this position on the map for as long as they want.
Makes a lot of sense. It's about just the enemy not being aware of where your jungler can be and you knowing that they don't know. It's the known unknowns of Summoner's Rift.
And being able to bring the additional person. Ooh,
this is... I mean, Rather is quite far up here, though.
Certainly is. However, trying to bait for Boogie also has the ability to bring both Betty and Chelsea to the play.
Santos has to stand united.
But that's
though.
Only one member and a shield.
Here we go. Scatter the weak onto Rather. Dark Stomper onto Nomads. Boogie waiting. And Anastix going to jump forward. Looking for the Dragon Rage. Rather flashes away. Here's the Abyssal Voyage. Turnball coming in as well from Flash Wolves as they take the fight. Stand United used. Boogie goes low. Void rushed in. Boss now. World Ender on that front line. And Anastix survives. Gets out to the back of it. All five members of Flash Wolves are here. Still Morgana on her way down. Gadget coming in. Boss with the knockup onto Hanabi. Are they going to look for the die? Vega could keep taking this, but the damage goes back onto Vega. They have to step back. Here comes Gadget on towards the back line. Looking for that binding. Trying to connect, can't quite find it, but the tower is low here. The minion wave pushing in. Gadget taking a lot of damage. Santa maybe looking for the taunt here as Anastix rejoins. Gadget overstepped. Way too far forward. The rest of his team couldn't back him up.
Manic, Vega just won a 4v5, and then Gadget walks into the remaining four members.
Oh, no, they did not. The Realm Warp spells the demise of Nomads and Boss and Vega Squadron. For a moment, there was a glimmer of hope, but Flash Wolves just broke them right down.
Tragedy on Summoner's Rift. They're going to look to continue.
And Anastix caught out. Hanabi and Boogie get the kill. And head-in-hand stuff here for Vega Squadron.
And what could have been a way back into the map? We said this at best is a 4v5. Let's watch how it goes. Shockwave used on only one target. Ideal start. You can see Rather solo, no way to rejoin this fight. And check out where Gadget is. He's still walking in, but Boss and Santas do a great job of frontlining, layering their CC perfectly, able to win this one out. At this stage, collapse, go get vision control, you know, have a look at things like the jungle, like the dragon. Instead, Gadget tries to go fishing, but does not catch anything, gets caught out of position, and ultimately costs his team another 3 kills after this.
Yeah, Hanabi here with the reflex around warp knew that Vega had split up. Quite easy for him just to follow this up. And then Anastix, of course, dies on the back end of it all.
That should have been a turret. That should have been the map opening up complete control over this dragon that's coming up in 15 minutes. This should be a Flash Wolves face checking into complete darkness with no global summoner spells apart from Betty's teleport. Instead, now they find themselves in, once again, a 3,000 gold lead and the ability to go back into this pseudo 1-3-1 comp.
And the question we asked ourselves was, where would the physical damage come from Vega? And I said, Boss, where he's behind. He's not in a position where he's really going to be impacting these fights, whereas you've got Ginsu's Rageblade, Blade of the Ruined King, finished on Varus. You've got a 4-1-1 rise in the top lane on the side of Flash Wolves. Any teamfight that erupts now, you have to feel goes in Flash Wolves' favor.
And I feel like that scoreline from Hanabi is going to be the most impactful area, because if they can keep Boss away from the main body of the fight, no extended damage going to be coming out of any other members of Vega Squadron. It's going to be a full burst fight if you were able to survive or negate the initial portion. As Betty gets caught out slightly.
Binding into Tormented Sword still does a lot of work here from Gadget.
Then Betty's just going to be able to out DPS race. If he lives, you know, through a good devour, through the shields that are going to be available from Rather, then it is very easy to play the front-to-back composition on the side of Flash.
Imagine if that tower was down. Rather wouldn't be able to stand where he's standing right now. Wouldn't be able to back there. The Rune Prism's going to land on towards Boss there. The chase in from Chelsea and Betty. Realm Warp there as well. Boss does have the flash, but he doesn't really have anywhere to go. Tries to flash away back towards the Flash Warp's base, but the piercing arrow won't quite connect. Boss, he's going to get chased down here by someone in the end. Dies to minions, and Betty will collapse. And Anastix is going to play down towards the bottom side of the map, get something out of this for Vega Squadron.
And they look for the dive here. Vine goes wide, so it will just be the dragon coming across. You thought with how long it took to take down Boss, there was something else available. However, now with the threat over Baron, they can't even take bot lane turret. Mid's still going to stand.
So there's no control ward on this, and there was a ward in the back of the pit, I believe, for Vega. It has just died off, so I don't think Flash Wolves will go for the Baron. Just wanted to get control over the area.
So much better play from Vega. Once again, taking the dragon, trading. I would have liked to see Boss show a little bit more restraint, not go for that one-on-one, especially given the fact that, you know, we've already pointed out very strong rise at this stage of the game. But at least they don't compound the initial mistake. They're willing to trade cross-map. They grab themselves a turret. They grab themselves the dragon. That's honestly a positive trade right now for the Vega lineup.
You take it. It's still only 3,000 gold behind as well. They're coming into the 23-minute mark. Last time, the game was over by this point, pretty much. So Vega Squadron having a much better performance here in game four.
And if the buttons land onto a key member, if it is going to be rather or Betty in these teamfights that get blown up, they still have avenues to be able to take the fight. And then, better yet, if somehow they wrestle back control of a quadrant, if they get a face-checking target, they have a very nice zone control, you know, AoE-style composition that they can implement.
Just need to find that proactive play once again. They tried, they did it really well earlier on, 12-minute mark, making those plays towards mid lane. Now we need to see them do it again, because otherwise Flash Wolves, you feel, are just going to continue to starve the life out of Vega. That's going to deny all of this vision, all of this experience.
Pretty interested in Gadget's build right now as well, Medic. Hold that thought.
Shadow Corruption doesn't quite connect onto Gadget. He uses the Black Shield and flashes away. Santos gets across towards the top side of this. Boogie on the chase. Binding doesn't connect either. Santos was able to hold his flash there, whereas Gadget had to use his.
Yeah, great reflexes, however, shown to deny two kills going across from Gadget being able to eat the key ultimate. And it's going to be in Morale and Omicron picked up for the Morgana. Generally, you read Ingenious, run Ingenious Hunter. Hold that again.
Oh, Betty, underneath the tower here. Scatterfall doesn't quite hit. Just wide there. Betty able to get out with his life. The tower falls. Three towers to two in favor of Flash Wolves.
And if you're Betty, you know that you have, you know, potentially a Tom Kench around to save you, but the ability to just dodge out on key skill shots and keep himself healthy. And it is going to be, as you just pointed out, Twin Shadows up next. However,
Oblivion Orb just for the extra penetration early on, I guess.
Yeah, it certainly could be the case, especially given the fact that, you know, there are some magic resistance items being built up. I just feel like at this stage, you really do need that Zonya's Hourglass as well. You need the triple actives if you're going to have any presence in these teamfights. Given that he's running Teleport, the flanks just become so much more potent. And the ability to buy crucial moments for people like Boss and No Man's to land their damage is also going to be very relevant in these team fights.
Like this from Vega though, trying to find the time to get some vision control around this Baron. They do need to clear out the pit. There's still a control ward there and one behind them at the back of their red buff. But they knew that recalls had happened from the side of Flash Wolves, and so they were able to just find the time to get in there. Boss will use the Umbral Dash across the wall here, and it's fine.
Great play from Boss this time around, showing the restraints. As soon as you get Ryze ulted on, you know that someone is heading down. Get both globals out. Sure, teleport's still available for Hanabi, but no way to keep Rather safe in this side lane now.
And Anasik not quite able to land the Sonic Wave there. It felt like No Man's was already starting to back off, and so didn't really want to go too far.
And this is the area where you finally get to critique Flash Wolves. Hanabi in the 1v1 is going to have push priority. He's got four kills. He's a Ryze going towards the latter stages of the game. Why are you using Tahm Kench ult to try and take down Boss? You need it to keep your Orianna safe. Now there's no option to play the 1-3-1. Riley's gonna have to group and just catch side lanes. It's gonna cost you CS. But if they make a fight here work, it doesn't matter.
Shade of Corruption lands onto Santos, but immediately puts down the Spirit's Refuge, blocking out those auto attacks. Betty flashing forward. The flank is on here for Anasik. If they can find it, they're in a good position. Him and the Syndra on the side.
Yeah, far away,
Rather
is
not with them. Anasik's gonna jump in. Boss there on the front line now. Redemption used by Xiao Si. Boss into the World Ender, not quite into the Redemption Passive. No Man's there with the Unleashed Power. They take down Betty. That's one. Boogie jumps on the back line though. Gadget. Shockwave back will fall, and Flash Wolves find the fight. Hanabi can just open up Machine Gun Ryze onto the faces of Vega. Boss gets a counter kill, but it's going to be a full ace here by the Flash Wolves. Boogie on the chase, and Anasik not really anywhere for him to go apart from across the wall. Boogie still chasing him. It's jungler versus jungler. The prey sequel here hit, and there is the smite in the end.
Yeah, it certainly is, and Santos will survive on the back end of it all. However, it is going to be a 4-for-2 trade, and that was the perfect team fight for Vega Squadron. They had the initial pick. They landed the CC onto Betty. But this Ryze is just such a massive problem, and it could lead to a Baron.
Definitely can. When you have something like a Ryze, you can take these Barons pretty quickly. Boogie there. Santa's looking for the steal if he can get it. We've seen one steal already this best of five, and Anasik was the one to get it. But Santa's, you can blast going in. You can go for the auto instead. Just taunt straight in. Rather secures it. Santa's stopwatches for a second, but that's not going to delay his demise for long. Hanabi unstoppable now. 6-1-5. And Flash Wolves have taken this game by the scruff of the neck.
They certainly have, but it took longer. This is still 26 minutes into the game. Vega giving as good as they got. And I love the proactive play here. It looks like Flash Wolves are opening up. You know, this is against the flow. How do you escort your Orianna in? There's, she has to walk through potentially two members. Sure, gets the summoner spell out, but as soon as Santos can complete this recall, can always rejoin. So Vega go aggressive. Landing a very nice combo on the back end right here, out of the Lee Sin. Lobs the crucial member of the Varus forward. And the World Ender just zoning on the back end. Enter mentioned, however, as soon as Hanabi was able to join, the fight really was over. With less of a gold lead, this looks much better for the Vega lineup, and you kind of get shades of what their comp was supposed to accomplish.
Against a worse team on the day, they definitely could have taken this series. Of course, they play up against Fongvu Buffalo if they lose this game tomorrow.
Jury's still out on whether Fongvu are weaker than Flashwolves, however.
Yeah, that's the question, isn't it? They look very strong against against Team Liquid today. Santa's with the taunt from the side. Hanabi's up towards the top lane. Unleash Power's gonna land. Rather's down. Boss continuing to chase in here with the Stand United. They've taken the Inferno Drake. Great taunt onto Betty. Boss on the chase. Betty's down, and Vega have found the fight. They're gonna take out Xiaosi as well. With the thick skin, he just about survives, but Ananasit can just chase him down. Should be another kill for Vega. Hanabi is in the base. Boogie gonna use the Void Rush here onto Gadget, but Gadget can just land the binding. Tormented Slow will tick away at him. Hanabi's still pushing for that inhib up towards the top side. He will secure it. So Flashwolves get the inhib, but they lose the fight in mid.
Two members will survive. However, they're looking to corral them, potentially cut them off. No, they will let them go. They're still Infernal Drake, a winning team fight. And potentially, you know, that overconfidence we saw when Rather was approaching mid lane turret and got picked off. This time around, you know, they hang around an objective that they obviously had no interest in fighting. That could have been a free inhibitor. Instead, they give away three kills.
Oh, teleport in here by Hanabi, though. Trying to catch Gadget and Nomads. He can just 1v3 this. Gadget's done. Hanabi, he's styling on some fools right now. The taunt from Santas will land, but Rather's here for the cleanup crew. It's a double for the Rise. Hanabi is unstoppable, indomitable, and he has won this game pretty much solo-handed for the Flashwolves.
And now the fact that they have two Baron buffs remaining becomes even more relevant. With two members, the wave cleared dead. This is going to open up a second portion of the map. If one more member of Vega gets picked off, that could be Flashwolves advancing to the group stage.
Vega may have taken the last fight, but as soon as Hanabi shows up, there's little they can do. Boss, Santas, and Ananasek trying to defend here, but they just can't even find a flank position. Double inhibitors down now. 30 minutes in. Flashwolves, 7,000 gold ahead. The shockwave lands onto Boss. He has the World Ender. He will regen. But even with that, Flashwolves can just take whatever they want out of this game. And Ananasek eventually realizes his hiding spot wasn't so subtle, and he will back away towards his base.
And now one more inhibitor before the whole break is base is opened up. Before Vega break, you can see they've had some areas where it looks like the team fight is good enough. But when you're playing against an 8-1-5 Ryze, it's nearly completed a fourth item on Summoner's Rift, the game becomes very difficult.
Yeah, pretty hard to play from this position. Of course, credit to Vega. They dominated their group 5-1. In the play-in stages, and then in game one against Flashwolves, they look very strong. Even portions of this game, they've looked very strong.
No, this game has looked very good for Vega. This shows what a creative draft does to this team. Unlocks their ability to make plays.
Yeah, and Hasek just forced back a little bit there. You can't hide in a bush when the Orianna ball is there.
However, in a standard game, all right, I'm not gonna talk.
Boss is caught out, shall we? See, coming in. And Hanabi will go legendary. That's not really too much you can do against this Ryze right now. Vega Squadron trying to find picks where they can, but reeks of desperation for them right now.
Yeah, it certainly is. And I mean, this game has deteriorated quite rapidly after the Baron was taken. However, at the same time, you have to credit the ability to play the map and, you know, generate some leads. You feel like if Gadget and Boss didn't overextend in those two crucial moments, would be singing a different tale as Vega was stalling out quite nicely. But now it becomes quite pedestrian. You've already got double inhib down. You're against a global composition with a very fed Ryze. You need to make a last stand somewhere, and it's probably going to have to be this inhibitor turret.
Three items on Betty as well. Three completed on Rather. He's got the Spellbinder in his back pocket. Vega.
This is the safest Varus ever. Has a stopwatch, has himself a time catch with cleanse, as well as a QSS.
And he's got the Maw of Malmortius in case he ever gets caught out as well. So very, very safe Varus. Very, very safe close here, you think, for the Flashwolves. It's the final stand for Vega. Hold them here. Hot gates, but with super minions pushing in the top lane and in the mid, it's going to be a very difficult hold.
Well, this is the impressive thing. You can see that Flashwolves still pinging out the lane waves on which they want to dive for. Not playing around the mid lane wave at all. They pinged the top lane wave that they wanted to have crash. Now we'll see it.
Teleport coming in behind. Three members of Flashwolves here. Rather, Betty and Xiaosi maybe caught out. Boogie coming in from the side as well, but Boss lands onto Betty. The unleashed power into the stopwatch. He may be very safe, but he is still dead. Hanabi, though, and Boogie are on the Nexus Towers. They don't really care about the kills. All they care about is the Nexus, and all they care about, all Flashwolves ever care about, is making the main stage of MSI. Can they do it? He says, I'm pretty sure they can. Hanabi takes the Nexus, and Flashwolves are going to the main stage.
So they throw Betty to the, not wolves, because they're wolves, to the other people.
To the sharks.
To the sharks, there we go. And unfortunately, he will fall down, but they will end up winning the series. And once Flash Wolves got into their grooves, you really saw how well they can play the map. But not only that, they do still have very impressive individual members. And that's what I feel like everyone's going to talk about. Without Caster, without Maple, without Sword Art, how can this LMS squad stand up? And you can see already they do have very good substitutes in place of those players.
They definitely do, developing as a squad game to game as well. I think the question does remain, how will they face up against a G2, against an SKT, against a Team Liquid, against an IG? But strong performances all around from the Flash Wolves, from the LMS.